my fear by the side of the road. I hear you speak, I won't let go. I fall to my knees as I lift my hands to pray. Got every reason to be here again. My father's love that draws me in, and all of my eyes when I see is a glimpse of you. And all I need is you. Spirit calls my heart to sing. I'm drawn to the voice of my Savior once again. What would my soul be without your Son? He gave his life to save the earth. I rest in the thought that you're watching over me. And all I need is you. All I need is you, Lord, is you, Lord.
Call on a man who conquered it. Thy strength indeed is small. Child of weakness, watch and pray. Find in me thy all in all. Lord, now indeed I find thy power and thine alone can change the leopard spots and melt the heart of stone. Jesus paid it all. To him I owe. Sin has left a crimson stain. He washed him white as snow. For nothing good have I, whereby thy grace to claim. I'll wash my garments white in the blood of Calvary's Lamb. Jesus paid it all to you, my.
Welcome. Hey, before we start here, I want to welcome the folks watching online. In most of our church during this season, I'd say there's about a fourth of us that are probably in the building, but probably three quarters of our body watches online. So we want to acknowledge you guys and thank you for joining us on whatever screen you're watching this from. We just pray you sense the Lord's presence and thank you for tuning in. And before we start here, Galatians 6, verse 9 says this. Let us not grow weary while doing good, for in due season we'll reap if we don't lose heart. And man, this is a season that we need to hear that verse, huh? Don't grow weary while doing good, for in due season we'll reap if we don't lose heart. And one of the ways we don't lose heart is to have fellowship with each other and remind ourselves that we're part of this body and that we're all in this together. So let's pray, and then we'll start worshiping. Lord, help us not to lose heart, and help us to focus on you, Lord, during this season. Help us to remember each other in prayer, and if we're able to actually physically be in the same room with each other. For those who can't and are not able, Lord, Lord, I pray that they would just be blessed in their living room right now or wherever they're watching this, Lord. And I pray that our church, that we wouldn't lose heart, Lord. We would just be encouraged, and as we just think about you every day, and especially today on Sunday as we gather, Lord, we just pray that we would bless you in this gathering, Lord, that you would be pleased, and that your people right here, Lord, and wherever they're watching from, Lord, would just be blessed and encouraged and built up. In your name we pray, amen. Well, let's worship.
Amen. Invite y'all to stand if you want to stand. If you want to stay seated, it's okay with that too. Amen.
As we wait upon the Lord, wait upon the Lord, we will wait upon the Lord. Our God, you reign forever, ever, our strong deliverer. You are. Defender take me deep. Lift us up all the way. Fly deep.
Strength will rise.
The strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. Wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. Rises, we wait upon the Lord. Wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. Oh God, you reign forever. You are the everlasting God. The everlasting God. Do not think you will go free. You are defender of the weak. He comforts those in need. Lift us up on the way. Like you are the everlasting. You are.
Father, we do come before you, Father, and we wait upon your name. We wait upon them, what you have called us to do. And Father, we know it with the assurance that as we wait upon you, we will grow stronger as you lead us, Father, in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. If you want to be seated, you can be seated. Amen.
Sing like never.
Father, we thank you so much that we can stand before you, be here, Lord God, worshiping your holy name. Even though we don't need to be here, Lord, we know that you are everywhere. But Father, it is good to come together to give you praise, Lord.
Cry of my heart is to bring everlasting. Your light will shine when all else fades. Never ending. Your glory goes beyond the pain. The cry of my heart is to bring you praise from the inside. Our Lord, my soul cries out.
Times when that we cannot see the light, but as we sang, Father, your light is what shines out even more in the darkness, Lord. Lord, even if we see darkness around us, Father, the hint of light just shuns it. And Father, we know that you are your Son. Jesus Christ is the Son, is the light of the world. We give you praise, we give you glory and honor. Father, we keep our hearts open for your word as we worship you through hearing your word, Father. We thank you and we ask you this in Jesus' name. Amen. And amen. We'll call Wayne. Wayne's going to bring in the announcements. Amen.
Well, good morning, everybody. Just wanted to remind you all, especially those of you at home, this is the first Sunday of the month, so we will be having communion today. Those of you that are here, if you didn't pick up the elements, they're on the back table. Those of you at home, make sure you gather the elements together so you can join us at the end of the service and we'll take communion together as a family. As far as church service, we encourage you, those who are at risk or show symptoms, please stay at home. Don't take chances, err on the side of safety and caution. If you do come, we have masks here for you. We have hand sanitizer available. The church is constantly being cleaned, so we hope to see you all here soon. No kids ministry, no nursery ministry for the next few weeks. We are going to have a men's breakfast here at church in person August 15th at 8:30. So we encourage all you men here and those of you that are home to come and join us. Midweek ministries, Monday, 6:30, the women's ministry. Zoom only at this time. So if you want to join that, if you haven't already joined, call the office and we'll give you the information for that. Friday night men's studies at 7 p.m. We are going to start meeting here at 7. So we encourage you guys to all come here and join in with us. Wednesday night service is on summer break. We'll start again in September. Cypress Crayer Nursing Home Ministry, still on hiatus. Usually this is every second and fourth Sunday of the month. And we'll let you know when that starts back up. Israel trip. If you've never been to Israel, man, I encourage you guys to go. It'll change your life. Definitely change how you read the Bible. If you're interested, we have information in the back, in the foyer, in the lobby, excuse me. Prayer meetings, Sunday, we meet here at 9:30 before service, and then we have a prayer meeting at 11:30 after service here in the sanctuary. And if you do have prayer requests, we have prayer box here, and you can also call the office or email your prayer requests to the office. All right, God bless you guys.
Check. Oh, there we go. We're on. All right. Hey, if you haven't gotten one of these little things, high-tech communion packs, if you haven't got it, go ahead and go to the back and grab one, because that way you don't have to go back there later when we have communion. So take this moment. If you don't have this, and they're right out there by the door, and you can grab your own, and you can save that for the end of service. And also, you can look at it, too, to figure out how you're going to open it. Because it takes, it's kind of deceptive. It has two little openings. I've been tricked by them before. But anyway, we just want to eliminate distractions by the time we get to that portion of our service. We want to be as distraction-free as possible. Well, right now, turn in your Bibles to Matthew chapter 26, and we're going to keep going where we left off in Matthew. We're going to pick up where we left off in Matthew, and we're going to pick up in verse 47. And by the time we get done with the end of our study, we'll make our way all the way down to verse 68. And before we start, let's just have a quick word of prayer here. Lord, thank you for your word. Thank you that as we read just your scripture, Lord, it's not just not the words of men, or just it's not a history book, or it's just not an interesting story, or it's not a myth, but this is actual. These are facts that we're reading about. This is a true historical account of you, Jesus, but there's something special about your words, God. It breathes life into us. It gives us light. It convicts us, Lord. It comforts us. It encourages us, Lord. It builds us up, and we can't live without it as Christians, Lord. So we just want to be mindful of that as we're covering your word this morning, Lord. So we pray specifically that this scripture would be a word in season to somebody who's weary this morning, Lord, that it would just encourage your people as we read about how much you suffered for us, Lord. Let us just be reminded of how much you love us, Lord. In your name we pray, amen. Well, Galatians chapter 6, verse 9 says this, "Let us not grow weary while doing good, for in due season we'll reap if we don't lose heart." And I think now more than ever, we're sensing the need as Christians to have spiritual endurance, huh? Have you noticed that? Especially with this pandemic. It's gone on longer than we want it to, and we're just kind of, it feels like we're getting run down a little bit, and we want to be done with this pandemic, but I think I think that's just a kind of a picture of life, you know? Life is a marathon, isn't it? And it's not a sprint, and Amazing Grace, I think it's the fourth verse that says, "The Lord has promised good to me. His word my hope secures. He will my shield and portion be as long as life endures." As John Newton wrote that, I could just sense him singing, man, life is long, and it's something to be endured. And how do we endure? I mentioned earlier before the service, one great way to endure is to stay in fellowship. It's very important if you can't be here to tune in and to know that you're not alone. And we check out, we want to give up when the devil tricks us into isolating ourselves and so forth. And that's a sure way to give up and to check out on our faith. Another great way, I would say an even better way to also endure is to think about Jesus. Listen to this. Hebrews 12, verse 3 says, "Consider him who endured such opposition from sinners so that you will not grow weary and lose heart." In fact, that's one great reason to fellowship, because the ultimate goal is to get our minds back on the Lord. And I can't think of any other passage that does that more for us than the passage that we're going to be in today. Consider Jesus, lest you grow weary and lose heart. And so that's been my prayer as we go through this passage, that any of you who in here this morning are weary or just feeling like you want to check out on your faith, it's been my prayer that this passage this morning would help you just consider Jesus and be boosted in your faith this morning. So anyway, Matthew 26, we're continuing to look at the last hours of Jesus before he goes to the cross. And basically everything in the book of Matthew has been leading up to this point. This is pretty much the apex of Jesus' earthly ministry. We left off last week in verse 46. Jesus was coming out of the Garden of Gethsemane with his disciples. And we saw that when he was in the garden, he prayed when it was hardest to pray. And the great battle that he would fight later on the cross, I think that battle was won previously the night before in the Garden of Gethsemane. And we talked about last week how a lot of our battles are either won or lost before we even get to the battlefield. Depending on how well we're prayed up is going to depend on it, that, you know, our victory or our defeat, hinges on that. And so here Jesus, he's won the battle even before he gets to the cross, and he did it that night at Gethsemane. The rest of chapter 26, we see three movements, and it's the betrayal, the trial, and then we see the denial of Peter. We're going to get to the denial section next week. I thought we'd make it all the way down to verse 75. That's just too much to cover, and I didn't think you guys wanted to hear me speed talk our way through this. So we're just going to go through the betrayal, number one, to look at two things, the betrayal, and then secondly, the trial of Jesus this morning. And then next week, we'll look at Peter. So number one here, the betrayal, that's in verses 47 through 56, and we'll divide this little section into four little subsections here. Number one here, the people involved in the betrayal. Notice in verse 47 here, and while Jesus was still speaking to his disciples, behold, Judas, one of the 12, with the great multitude, with swords and clubs, came from the chief priests and the elders of the people. So number one here, the people involved in the betrayal. We see several people mentioned here in verse 47. And the first person we see mentioned is Judas. Notice in verse 47. In verse 47, he's referred to as one of the 12. All four gospel writers, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, as they're describing this, they talk about Jesus as being one, they talk about Judas as being one of the 12. Now, if I was one of the gospel writers, I wouldn't refer to Judas in that way. I'd refer to him, then the jerk Judas showed up. Then the horrible, malicious monster, Judas himself, showed up with a detachment of troops. But notice all the gospel writers, they don't refer to him that way. James 4:11 says, don't speak evil of one another, brethren. And so they just simply refer to him as one of the 12. But what goes along with that term, one of the 12, tells us that Judas had a lot of privilege. He had a lot of opportunity. He had a unique privilege and opportunity to be that close to Jesus for over 3 years. That's incredible. And so one of the 12. Also, that term kind of reminds us of the tragedy of Judas's life. So tragic to be that close to Jesus for three and a half years, but yet never get saved. It's totally possible to be really close to somebody who's on fire to Jesus. It's totally possible to even have verses in the Bible memorized. It's totally possible to be associated with the church, with people who know Jesus, but you yourself never know Jesus. That's totally possible. And Judas is a classic but tragic example of that. And also thinking about Judas, that night, it's got to be a really frantic night for Judas here because he's kind of working overtime. He's got to find the Sanhedrin in the middle of the darkness. He's got to do all the coordinating and the logistics of assembling this multi-force SWAT team to cause this arrest to happen. And I wonder at what point did the disciples finally catch on and realize, oh, it was Judas that Jesus was talking about this whole time. He has always been talking about the last few years how one of us would betray him, especially earlier this night. He's really been talking about how somebody around the table would betray him. And no, none of these guys really ever suspected Judas until Judas comes into the garden. And then I wonder if it clicked for the disciples. Notice the second person or people mentioned here in verse 47, Judas number one, but number two, the great multitude. Notice they've got swords and clubs with them. Now, don't think of an angry, chaotic mob. That's not what we see here. John helps us out in John 18, verse 3, says this, Judas, having received a detachment of troops and officers from the chief priests and Pharisees, came there with lanterns and torches and weapons. So John tells us that a detachment of troops was led by Judas to the garden. A detachment of troops, what's that mean? It'd be like a battalion of troops. A detachment was a tenth of a legion. A legion was 6,000. So a modern-day battalion would be about 600. That's what a detachment pretty much was here. So you've got 600 trained professional Roman soldiers coming up to arrest Jesus, led by Judas. Also, in addition to those 600 soldiers, you've got the temple guard with them as well. We don't know how many soldiers that would be. Also, we know that there was other religious guys there as well. So you total it all up, there might be about 1,000 people coming out to the garden to arrest Jesus. So no wonder in verse 47 here, Matthew describes it as a great multitude coming to arrest Jesus. What a scene. Now, if this happened today, I would guess these guys would be like decked out in their SWAT gear. They probably have automatic weapons and body armor and concussion grenades and helmets and goggles and battering rams. That's the scene coming out to get Jesus. Almost 1,000 people involved in this SWAT mission. Why so many people just to get one guy? Well, obviously, they think Jesus is going to run, or they think that he's going to be a threat to them. And obviously, they just really don't know Jesus very well to think that. Notice another group of people here, the chief priests and the elders of the people in verse 47. In other words, these are just the major religious power players of the day. They're kind of in charge of this whole operation. They are the main instigators of sending out the SWAT team. So this wasn't just an angry, chaotic mob. This is a well-organized group of soldiers sent by the religious power players led by Judas. Notice the second thing here. In verses 48 through 50 here, we see the sign of the betrayal. The sign of the betrayal here. Notice in verses 48 through 50 here. Now his betrayer had given them a sign saying, whomever I kiss, he's the one. Seize him. And immediately he went up to Jesus and said, greetings, Rabbi, and kissed him. But Jesus said to Judas, friend, why have you come? Then they came and laid hands on Jesus and took him. So secondly, the sign of the betrayal. Verse 48, his betrayer had given him a sign saying, whomever I kiss, he's the one, seize him. Now in the Middle Eastern culture, you still go to Israel today, you see people, hey, good to see you, mwah, mwah. It's the typical kiss on the cheek greeting. A little different than here in Texas, right, where we shake hands. That'd be kind of weird to do a bunch of kissing at church, especially during COVID, probably not safe. But over there, still today, that's the common greeting, to do the kiss on the cheek. Now the question is, why did Judas need to signal who Jesus was with a kiss? And the answer is because everybody had heard of Jesus, but a lot of the soldiers wouldn't recognize him if they saw Jesus. Now that tells us something about Jesus. It tells us that he looked normal. And Jesus didn't have some golden frisbee floating above his head constantly. He didn't have his face glowing at all times. Oh, there's Jesus. You can tell by the frisbee and the face. His face glows. It's really cool. He's God. You know, no, Jesus looked like a normal dude. That's incredible. Isaiah 53 verse 2 says, there was nothing beautiful or majestic about his appearance, nothing to attract us to him. That's interesting. It's also interesting the first time John the Baptist saw Jesus. It says this in John 1:33, I wouldn't have known him except that the dove came down, the Holy Spirit came down, and kind of that was the signal and the way I could distinguish Jesus. He just looked like a normal dude, or else John never would have recognized him except for the Holy Spirit falling on him in some interesting way. So I think that's interesting. What's the point? The point is this. It's God's heart to be approachable. And if God would have sent Jesus down to be 10 feet tall with that golden halo over his head, he would have come across as unapproachable, right? And I think just even the way Jesus appeared in his human body just all points to God's heart. Everything about Jesus reflects God's heart perfectly. And God's heart is to be relatable to mankind. God's heart is to be approachable. And remember when Jesus was on the cross, what happened with the temple veil? It ripped from top to bottom. It ripped from God down to man. And what was on the other side of that veil in the Holy of Holies? The presence of God was represented in there. And the sign, the statement is this: when Jesus died and that veil ripped, you know, it was like God saying, hey, the sin has been taken care of by my son's death on the cross. Come on in now and have fellowship. The curtain used to say, stand back or you will die if you come in here. But now the curtain has been ripped. God's saying, I want to be approachable. I want to have fellowship. That can happen now because Jesus has taken your sin on the cross. And we see that even reflected in the way Jesus looked as a person. He wasn't standoffish. He wasn't unapproachable. Everything about Jesus is saying, God saying, I want to relate to people. That's God's heart. Getting back to Judas here, he comes up to Jesus in the garden and he says, greetings, Rabbi, and he kissed him. Now Luke tells us that Jesus responded and said, Judas, are you betraying the Son of Man with a kiss? Wow. So basically Jesus says in Luke 22, Judas, are you so dead to all feeling that you can betray me like this? I think Judas here is a great example of somebody with a calloused conscience. It's totally possible that our conscience can be calloused. We're told elsewhere in the epistles that our consciences can be seared as with a hot iron. It's like we have no more nerve endings in our conscience. The things that used to startle us no longer startle us because we're desensitized. And that's the way it is here with Judas. And the way that he kissed Jesus, I think this is interesting. It wasn't just the normal, mwah, mwah, the peck on the cheek. The Greek tense implies that Judas smothered Jesus with kisses. In other words, Judas made a big scene pretending to really be devoted to Jesus. In fact, the other time we see this Greek word for kissed here, there's a couple words in Greek. One is a peck on the cheek, the typical greeting. But the word here means smothered with kisses. Another place we see this is in the parable of the prodigal son. Remember that? In Luke chapter 15, verse 20. Remember when the prodigal son decided to return home? Remember that? And he arose, Luke 15, 20. He came back to his father. And when he still was a great way off, his father saw him, had compassion on him, and ran and fell on his neck and kissed him. That word for how the father kissed the prodigal son, that word is smothered the prodigal son with kisses. Wow. So here with Judas, the deception and the false affection was just intense. It was with intensity that Judas pretended to love Jesus. There's that proverb. Proverb 27:6 says, "Faithful are the wounds of a friend, but the kisses of an enemy are deceitful." It's also interesting to think about this. By this point in the evening, we know from Luke 22 and also John 13 that by this point in the evening, Judas is possessed already by Satan. That's interesting. So apparently, the way that Judas is kissing Jesus, it had something to do with the power of Satan's influence on his life at that point. He was being extremely hypocritical and showy about it. And so the point is, Satan is intensely deceitful. Under his control, this is the way that Judas acts. Just heartless, extremely hypocritical. Notice the third thing about the betrayal, the people involved, the sign of the betrayal. But thirdly here, the defending at the betrayal. Notice somebody tries to defend Jesus in verse 51. This is interesting. "And suddenly, one of those who was with Jesus stretched out his hand and drew his sword, struck the servant of the high priest, and cut off his ear." Wow. Now that's interesting because there's hundreds of soldiers here, and yet one of Jesus' men decides he's going to take on the whole lot of them by himself. Now, who would do such a thing? Who would do such a thing? One guy pretending like he's Rambo, taking on a whole detachment of trained professional Green Berets. Well, John 18:10 tells us, Simon Peter, of course, right? Having a sword, drew it, struck the high priest's servant's ear, cutting off his right ear, and the servant's name was Malchus. So we know that the guy who got his ear chopped off, the servant of the high priest, his name is Malchus, John tells us. Also, John tells us it was Peter who was doing the sword swinging here. Now, what in the world is Peter doing here? This is so out of touch with the plan, isn't it? Well, no doubt, Peter feels the need, well, to prove himself, doesn't he? Why? Because earlier that evening, he boasted about how he'd never deny Jesus. These other losers around me might, but not me, you know? So now he feels like he's got something to prove. And you know what? People who feel like they've got something to prove, especially in ministry, or especially if they feel they've got to prove themselves about how spiritual they are, sometimes those people scare me a little bit, you know? Because they're like a loose cannon. You never know who they might hurt. And it's usually because there's some insecurity and they feel they've got to prove themselves. And here, that's Peter right here, and he ends up cutting off a guy's ear. Now, Luke tells us something interesting. Luke tells us this because Luke is a doctor. Luke tells us in Luke 22:51, Jesus said, "No more of this," and he touched the man's ear and healed him. That's something a doctor would take note of. And so it's interesting when you read Luke's Gospels about how Luke's Gospel about how Jesus healing the leper and how Jesus sweat great drops of blood, and hear how Jesus, you know, put back Malchus's ear back on his head. Luke, you know, mentions those things because Luke's a doctor and thinks that's pretty fascinating. You don't have to go into an OR room to put an ear back on. That's neat. Jesus just put his ear back on his head. What would you do if you were Malchus? I'd be having second thoughts about arresting this guy, you know? At the same time, I'd be like, thank you, Jesus. Okay, now let's carry on with the arrest. Kind of weird. Two things about Malchus's ear being healed here. Number one, it speaks of Jesus's incredible love for his enemies. You know, this guy is a total enemy of Jesus, yet Jesus heals his ear. Sound familiar? Yeah, it does, because we've all been enemies of God before. Romans 5:10, we've been enemies of God, but God loved us first. Incredible. Also, the second thing here about the healing of Malchus' ear, it also speaks of the incredible hatred and hard-heartedness of Jesus' enemies. It's astonishing that they actually carry on with the arrest as if nothing unusual happened after this. Isn't that amazing? You'd think they'd say, okay, our bad, Jesus, we won't arrest you. Moments before this also, John tells us in John 18, when Jesus said, who are you looking for? They said, we're looking for Jesus. And Jesus goes, I am. And they all fell down. that'd be another reason to say, I think I'm going to not be on the SWAT mission. We're not going to arrest this guy. But they push through these obstacles, and they arrest him anyway as if nothing unusual happens. That just shows how hard-hearted and how much they hated Jesus. Also, we see a couple things about Peter here with this sword-swinging incident. Number one, real simple here, Peter is not a swordsman. Peter's a fisherman, right? And no doubt, Peter's aiming for his head. Peter missed. Why? Because he's not a swordsman. Peter is out of his gifting. The point is for us, stay in our gifting. Peter's an apostle. He's not a Navy SEAL guy with a sword here. And I think bad things happen when we get out of our giftings and we start doing things that God's never called us to do. The second thing we see about Peter is he's fighting a spiritual battle, but he's doing it with a carnal weapon. He's using the wrong weapon. Ephesians 6:12 says, we don't wrestle against flesh and blood, but against spiritual hosts of wickedness in the heavenly places. We are in a spiritual battle. And how often do we huff and puff in the flesh and we use carnal, physical weapons trying to win a spiritual battle? Peter should have been praying, right? He should have been prayed up. We saw that earlier in the chapter. In Ephesians chapter 6, verses 13 through 18, Paul mentions the armor of God and some of the bits about the armor of God, the belt of truth, the breastplate of righteousness, the shoes of peace, the sword of the Spirit, the shield of faith, and so forth. But at the end of that long list, there's this bit about prayer that oftentimes we leave out of the armor of God, but that's part of the armor of God text. Ephesians 6:18 says, praying with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit. Prayer is part of our armor. And I think prayer oftentimes is the best thing we can do. It's often the hardest and the most neglected thing to do. Spurgeon put it this way, and I quote, it would have been far better if Peter's hands had been clasped in prayer instead of clasped around the sword. So Peter uses the wrong weapon for the wrong purpose with the wrong motive, all trying to prove his own spirituality. And here in Matthew 26, Peter was moving in his own power with his own agenda. And what happened? The result wasn't too good. He hurt somebody really badly, right? Now, later in the book of Acts, when Peter's filled with the Holy Spirit and he's under the Lord's agenda, then Peter's going to swing another sword in Acts chapter 2, the sword of the Spirit, right? And there, he doesn't cut off people's physical ears, but what does he do? He goes deeper than that. It says in Acts 2:37, he cut them to the heart with that message. So Peter eventually will learn how to use the sword, the correct sword, and he'll learn how to do it in the right way. Notice the fourth thing here, Jesus' words regarding the betrayal. Notice in verse 52 here, but Jesus said to him, put your sword back in its place. For all who take the sword will perish by the sword. This is such a chaotic, confusing scene, isn't it? As soon as Judas kisses Jesus, I can just imagine these Roman soldiers coming out of the shadows. It's him! Gosh! And all of a sudden, the disciples freak out, and Peter just woke up. He shouldn't have woke up. He shouldn't have never been asleep. He's groggy. Oh, what's going on? And he starts swinging. It's just chaos. Jesus is the only calm one in this whole situation, and Jesus is the only one speaking words of logic here. And basically, Jesus says in verse 52, look, Peter, my kingdom does not advance by physical force. Not like some other religions where kneel on the ground, we'll put a sword to your throat. You want to convert or die? You know, that is not the way of Jesus, is it? No. How does the kingdom of God really advance? Not by force, but by one person at a time choosing to love Jesus when they see who he really is and they put their faith in Christ. That's how it advances, not by force. Notice in verse 53 here, or do you think that I cannot now show... I'm sorry, verse 53. Or do you think that I cannot now pray to my Father and he will provide me with more than 12 legions of angels? And here Jesus, he could have had divine help if he wanted. There are more than 12 legions of angels on standby, you know, with their hands on their swords, ready to come as soon as Jesus signaled them. And that's pretty impressive. 12 legions of angels. How many angels would that be? 6,000 in a legion? We're talking about 72,000 angels. That's pretty impressive, isn't it? Especially when you consider in the Old Testament, in 2 Kings 19, just one angel killed 185,000 Assyrian soldiers. Wow, that was one angel, and that was easy for that angel in 2 Kings 19. What could 72,000 angels do if they were really trying to protect Jesus? Man, they'd destroy the whole, I mean, they'd just kill everybody. And Jesus had them on standby, or maybe they were just on standby on their own. These angels are probably thinking, okay, Father, tell us to come and protect him. And, you know, the order never comes. And they just have to stand there on ready, and they never come and rescue him. And Jesus says, if I did call these angels, verse 54, how then could the scriptures be fulfilled that it must happen thus? Verse 55 here, in that hour, Jesus said to the multitudes, have you come out as against a robber with swords and clubs to take me? I sat daily with you teaching in the temple, and you didn't seize me then. Verse 56, but all this was done, Jesus says, that the scriptures of the prophets might be fulfilled. Then all the disciples forsook him and fled. At the end of verse 56, that's when all the disciples just booked it. The disciples boasted previously that evening, we'll go with you, Jesus. We'll stay in jail with you, Jesus. If they arrest you, they're going to arrest us. What do? They flake out, just like Jesus said they would. But two things to note here in verses 54 through 56. Number one, Jesus addresses the injustice of this arrest. Verse 55, I was in the temple every day. Why didn't you arrest me then? What you're doing is shady and sketchy. Basically, Jesus here is confronting their cowardice. If you really have a legitimate reason to arrest me, then why are you doing it in some secret way? This is hypocritical, he's saying. The second thing Jesus addresses, though, is the sovereignty of God's plan. Now, this is key for us, because a lot of us feel that we live in a world of injustice, and we do, don't we? It's frustrating, right? Maybe you're going through a trial right now, and it's like, Lord, this is unjust. But notice what Jesus says in the middle of his unjust situation. Number one, he says, this is unjust. But number two, he says, God is still sovereign, and God is still working out his plan. Isn't that so key to us? We need to know God is still working even though we're not aware of it. So here Jesus says, look, scripture's being fulfilled. And the way that I'm being arrested in verse 56, scripture is being fulfilled here. In the way that I don't call these angels down to arrest me in verse 54. I mean, that would be the just thing. The angels come down and rescue me, but I'm not going to call the cavalry. I'm not going to do that. Wow, that would be the just thing. This is unjust that this is happening, but Jesus says God is working and scripture is being fulfilled that it goes down this way. Now later, Peter would realize this. At the time, Peter's freaking out. The other disciples think, this is so horrible. God is not at work in this situation. I know that for sure. Now later, on the other side of this horrible injustice, they'll look back and say, oh God, you were at work the whole time more than ever. And later in the book of Acts, in Acts 2:23, Peter preaches about this very incident. And listen to what Peter says. Jesus, being delivered by the determined purpose and foreknowledge of God, you've taken by lawless hands and crucified. So there, looking back on this situation in hindsight, Peter says, this was the plan all along. But at the time we're going through the trial, we can't see the plan a lot of times, can we? So what do? A lot of times we freak out, don't we? And we say, God, you're asleep. Or God, you'll never work this out for good. But when I read this section of scripture, Jesus says, God, you're sovereign even in the middle of my injustice. It helps me to remember, look, I can trust God, Romans 8:28, that he's working something out for good, even though I might not see it. We can so trust God's goodness. There's this quote by Spurgeon that goes, let me think of it. I don't have it in my notes. Somewhere in my brain, in the back of my brain. God is too good to be unkind, and he's too wise to be mistaken. I love that. Later, Peter would realize that. But the time here, but here during the trial, he doesn't realize that. God is too good to be unkind, too wise to be mistaken. Well, let's move on to our second point here. The betrayal, number one. Number two, the trial. Verses 57 through 68. Here we see the trial of Jesus. Now, when you read through all four gospel accounts, you see that Jesus actually went through six trials. Not just one trial, but he went through six trials, actually. He went through three religious trials, then he went through three civil trials. And so when you put them all together, you see that. So in John's gospel, the first trial that he went through, John tells us, was he was brought to Annas's place. And Annas was like the godfather of the religious power players. Annas was the ex-high priest whose son-in-law was currently on the throne, but Annas was the guy who called the shots from the shadows. And so they take him to Annas' place first, according to John. Then Annas says, we'll take him to the current high priest's place, take him to Caiaphas, and that's what we see here in Matthew 26. And then after that, they take him and have the official Sanhedrin meeting, and we're told in Luke 22:66, as soon as it was day, then they had all the Sanhedrin meet, and they determined that he was guilty. That's the religious trials, Annas, Caiaphas, Sanhedrin. Then there's the civil trials that he went through. They turned him over to the Roman government. And so they turn him over, number one, to Pilate. And then when Pilate finds that Jesus is from Galilee, what's he do? He kicks him over to Herod because that's part of Herod's jurisdiction. And Herod happens to be in town for the Passover. Well, Jesus goes over to Herod. Herod wants to, you know, be entertained by Jesus. Jesus, you know, won't entertain him. Jesus just remains silent. Herod's men of war, it says, just beat him to a bloody pulp and mock him. And then Herod kicks him back over to Pilate for the sixth trial. And so the trial that we're seeing right here in Matthew 26 is actually the second of six trials. John says they took him to Annas first, and now Matthew picks it up here when they take Jesus before Caiaphas. Let's get into it. Verse 57 here, the trial here. And those who had laid hold of Jesus led Jesus away to Caiaphas, the high priest, where the scribes and the elders were assembled. But Peter followed him at a distance to the high priest's courtyard, and he went in and he sat with the servants to see the end. Peter went in, he sat with the servants to see the end. Another version says he waited to see how it would all pan out. So they hold this trial at night, and also it takes place where? At the high priest's palace, not in the meeting hall in the temple. Now that is very unusual. That they would hold a trial at night, that's illegal, by the way, and also that they would hold a criminal trial at the high priest's house, that's also illegal. Normally, the Sanhedrin met in a large hall in the temple courts, so they're just in a hurry to have Jesus convicted and get him out of their mind so they can celebrate the Passover. Notice in verse 59 here, now the chief priests and the elders and all the council sought false testimony against Jesus to put him to death. This is like the ultimate kangaroo court here. Notice in verse 59, they sought false testimony against Jesus. Notice it doesn't say they sought the truth concerning Jesus' case. That's the way a court's supposed to be, right? A court is supposed to seek the truth in whatever the case is, right? What are they doing here? They've already got their minds made up. They sought false testimony against Jesus. So they've already got their minds made up. They've already got the verdict. Now they just have to go through the whole charade of having a trial, and they go through the motions to make it look as if justice is being carried out. That's what they're doing here. Notice in verse 60 here, but they found none. They found nothing to accuse him of. Even though many false witnesses came forward, they found none, verse 60. But alas, two false witnesses came forward, verse 61, and said, this fellow said, I am able to destroy the temple of God and build it back up in 3 days. The best they can do is come up with these false witnesses who have been coached to make up lies against him. And verse 60 tells us, even though many false witnesses came forward, they found none. They found no valid accusations against him. Mark tells us in Mark 14:56, many testified falsely against him, but their statements did not agree. And so in a court case, you've got to have two witnesses telling the same story, right? They couldn't even get that to happen here. And it's so interesting here, the fact that they can't come up with any legitimate accusations against Jesus is such a strong testimony to his life and his integrity. And this is very remarkable, especially when you consider how popular Jesus was. You couldn't be much more of a public figure than Jesus. He was constantly surrounded by people all the time, right? Normally, it's not too hard to find a little bit of dirt on somebody who's really popular, right? But not with Jesus. MacArthur put it this way, and I quote, the fact that not a single witness could be found to convict Jesus of wrongdoing is one of the strongest apologetics in all of Scripture for his moral and spiritual perfection. If any fault could have been found in him, it would have come to light here. And you got to remember, these guys are expert sin detectors, right? These religious guys, and they can't find any valid accusation against him. In verse 61 here, the only thing we see that these false witnesses really think they've got on Jesus is making like a basically a bomb threat. He said, I'll destroy this temple and I'll build it up again in 3 days, he said. That's the only thing they think they've got on them, the equivalent of a modern-day bomb threat. They get them on terroristic threatening charges. And what they're referring to here, of course, is something that happened 3 years prior to this. Remember what happened 3 years prior to this at the very beginning of Jesus' ministry? This kind of set the tone for the hostility that would come his way for the next 3 years. Remember what he did? He ransacked the temple. Remember that? At the beginning of his ministry. They use the temple as a money-making operation to rip off the people of God. So God comes in, Jesus, and he says, no, this is wrong. And he ransacks their money-making operation. You get somebody in the wallet, and they don't like you very much, right? From that point on, the religious leaders hate him. At the end of his ministry, Jesus does the same thing the week before he goes to the cross. So Jesus' ministry is bookended on either end with two different temple cleansings. But the first time that he did it, 3 years before this in John chapter 2, of course, that infuriates the religious leaders. And they say, what right do you have to come in here and tear up the place? And listen to what goes on here. John chapter 2. What are you doing? John chapter 2, verse 18. If God gave you authority to do this, show us a miraculous sign to prove it. All right, Jesus replied, destroy this temple, and in 3 days I'll raise it up again. What? They exclaimed. It's taken 46 years to build this temple, and you can rebuild it in 3 days? John 2:21 says, but Jesus said this, when Jesus said this temple, he meant what? His own body. So prove that you've got the authority to come in here and mess up our money-making operation. Jesus says, okay, I'm God, and I'll prove it when I rise from the dead in 3 days. So fast forward, 3 years later, the religious leaders still remember that incident, and here they deliberately twist that prophecy about him rising from the dead into a terroristic threat. Now, Mark gives us a little more info about this here. Mark 14, 57 through 59. Finally, some men stood up, gave this false testimony. We heard him say, I'll destroy this temple made with human hands, and in 3 days I'll build another made without human hands. But even then, they couldn't get their story straight. The best thing they've got him on are these terroristic charges here. But even then, they couldn't get their witnesses to line up. How frustrated would you be if you were one of these religious leaders? They're really frustrated. We'll see that in a second. But before we get there, I just wanted to point out this whole trial is just so wrong on so many different levels. They're breaking so many of their own laws. We don't have time to get into all the laws that they broke, so I'll just give you a few here. There were so many things totally illegal about what they were doing. Number one, according to Jewish law, only decisions made in the official meeting place were valid. Where are they meeting here? In Caiaphas's house. Not valid. Whatever they decide, it's not valid. According to Jewish law also, criminal cases could not be tried during Passover season. What day was it? Passover day. They're not supposed to hold a court case on Passover. According to Jewish law, only an acquittal could be issued on the day of the trial. Guilty verdicts had to wait one night to allow for feelings of mercy to arise. What are they going to do with Jesus? Guilty, kill him now. That's what they're going to do. That's illegal. According to Jewish law, all evidence had to be guaranteed by two witnesses who were separately examined and could not have contact with one another. That wasn't happening here. They broke that law. According to Jewish law, a false witness was punishable by death. We see all kinds of false witnesses, right? None of them were executed. According to Jewish law, a trial always began by bringing forth evidence for the innocence of the accused before the evidence of the guilt was offered. That was not done with Jesus. William Barclay puts it this way in his commentary. These were the Sanhedrin's own rules, and it is abundantly clear that in their eagerness to get rid of Jesus, they broke their own rules. Wow. Anyway, they're making all these accusations against Jesus. They're all false. How would you react if somebody did this to you? I'll tell you what I want to do. If somebody's trash-talking me and making up lies about me, what do I want to do? I want to defend myself, right? I want to defend myself instantly, right? That's what we would do. But what does Jesus do? He just remains silent through this whole thing. Notice in verse 62 here, and the high priest arose and said to him, do you answer nothing? What is it that these men testify against you? Verse 63, but Jesus kept silent. And I would imagine as the high priest is trying to get Jesus to talk, he's trying to get Jesus to say something incriminating about himself, Jesus is just silent, and he's just staring right at the high priest, not saying a word. Wow. One commentator put it this way, Jesus stood majestically silent. It was the silence of innocence, the silence of dignity, the silence of integrity, the silence of infinite trust in his heavenly Father. It was a silence in which the lying words against him reverberated in the ears of the guilty judges and their witnesses they had bribed. Wow. In the Old Testament, it was prophesied that Jesus would do just this. Isaiah 53:7 says, he was oppressed and treated harshly, yet he never said a word. He was led like a lamb to the slaughter. As a sheep is silent before the shears, he did not open his mouth. Wow. That prophecy is being fulfilled right here. After all the testimonies against Jesus, they still had nothing to convict him of. On top of that, Jesus' silence enraged them even more. Can you imagine how angry these guys are getting? Everything they're trying is not working. They've got him right here, but they can't convict him of anything. So here Caiaphas, becoming more and more frustrated, Caiaphas takes another approach. Desperate to incriminate Jesus, here Caiaphas puts him under oath, verse 63. I put you under oath by the living God, verse 63. Tell us right now if you're the Christ, the Son of God. Now Caiaphas and all these other guys, they know full well that Jesus has been making these claims that he's been God, right? So Caiaphas says, I put you under oath. I want you to say that right here in front of us right now. And Jesus goes, okay. And so finally, in verse 64, Jesus said to him, it is as you said. So Jesus finally breaks the silence. Why didn't he speak up before then, before this time? Why did he finally break the silence now with this question? Because finally, they're asking him a question that's worthy enough to be answered. All the other junk was just junk, right? He made up a bomb threat once. He did this. And Jesus just remained silent. But now it gets down to the heart of the issue. And Jesus says, you're not going to send me to the cross for making some terroristic bomb threat. Because I didn't do that, and that's not why I'm going to the cross. I'm going to the cross because I'm claiming to be God, and I am, and I'm going to bear your sins. Let's get that straight before I go to the cross. And so listen to Jesus' response here. It is as you said. Nevertheless, I say to you, hereafter you will see the Son of Man sitting at the right hand of the power and coming on the clouds of heaven. Wow. So here in Jesus' answer, I love how he just doesn't hold back. Here in his answer, he says, yeah, I'm the Messiah, I am God. And he takes both Psalm 110, verse 1. He also takes Daniel 7:13, which are well-known messianic psalms or Old Testament scriptures, and he applies them to himself right in the midst of these Sanhedrin guys. He says, I am the Messiah the Old Testament spoke of. I am God, just like you said that I claimed. I claim it right here. And right now, you think you sit in judgment of me? Well, you know what? Your judgment of me is the small thing. The infinitely bigger thing is that one day I'm going to come back and I will sit in judgment over you. That's what Jesus says. Wow. So Jesus says he's not only the Christ, but he's also going to come back and he's going to judge them. Well, how do you think they react to that? Oh, man, he really stirred up the hornet's nest with that. Notice in verse 65, then the high priest just tore his clothes. Caiaphas is so enraged at this point, he tears his clothes. He just flips out. Ripping one's clothes back then in that culture, if you were a Jewish person, that was an ancient expression of just deep grief and anger. Notice in verse 65, after he rips his clothes, he says, oh, by the way, one other thing about ripping clothes. According to Leviticus 10 and according to Leviticus 21, it was illegal for the high priest to rip his clothes. Isn't that interesting? So another thing that the high priest does wrong here. Just interesting. Notice in verse 65 here, Caiaphas, after he rips his clothes, he says, what further need do we have of witnesses? Look, you've heard his blasphemy. Verse 66, what do you think? And they all answered and said, kill him, he's deserving of death. Wow, so the whole council heard what Jesus said, and they all accuse him of blasphemy. And their accusation of blasphemy, of course, would have been correct, except in Jesus' case, he's actually really who he is claiming to be. So for Jesus, it wasn't a crime for him to declare who he really was. Notice in verse 67, then they spat in his face, beat him, and others struck him with the palms of their hands, saying, prophesy to us, Christ, who is the one who struck you? So once the death sentence was passed here, listen to this. this upstanding, stately group of dignified men. All of a sudden, their masks come off, and their real selves are revealed, and they are just brutal and crude and vulgar, and these guys just are monsters, and they beat him, and they spit on him, and these are the most upstanding men of all of Israel doing this to Jesus. And verse 68 tells us that as they beat him, they also mocked him. This is like the high priest and the most educated, smart guys in all of Israel mocking Jesus. Prophesy to us, Christ. Who's the one who struck you? Mark 14 gives us a little more detail. Mark 14, 65, then some begin to spit on him and to blindfold him and to beat him and to say, prophesy. The cruelty here. You know, boxers know how to roll with punches, right? You kind of minimize the effectiveness of the punch if you can kind of do this, you know, or... But when you catch one on the chin directly, that can cause damage. You'll lose the fight maybe. We see these NFL quarterbacks, you know, they know when they're about to get sacked, you know, and they can turn in such a way to minimize the impact, right? But man, when you watch a quarterback get blindsided, that's when they really get hurt because they can't flinch. They don't know the punch is coming. And so they blindfold Jesus here. He can't see where the punches are coming. He doesn't know how to flinch or roll with the punches. And they're mocking him, saying, who hit you? If you're the Christ, tell us who hit you. They'll later do the same thing when Jesus is on the cross. These dignified men will follow him all the way out to the cross, and they'll yell the same stuff at him when he's on the cross. If you're really the Christ, come down, they'll say. Incredible. And so as these religious guys are ruthlessly beating Jesus, what blows me away is that God didn't strike him dead on the spot. Isn't that crazy? If I was God, you know, we'd instantly just strike him with lightning. Just rain down judgment. Torture him first before they die, you know. And it's incredible that these 72,000 angels didn't come down as well. Can you imagine that? What are those angels thinking as they're watching Jesus being beat and mocked by these guys? I mean, they're just like, just looking for some sort of a signal from Jesus or the Father. Are you really, you don't want us to go and do something about this? And the Father just says, stop. Nope, nope, nope. I think the point here, this just shows us how patient God is towards his enemies. This just shows us how staggering the riches of his mercy are. G. Campbell Morgan says, as one reads this story, one wonders more and more at the greatest miracle of all, the patient suffering of the spotless one. Romans 2:4 says this, don't you see how wonderfully kind, tolerant, and patient God is with you? Does this mean nothing to you? Can't you see that his kindness is intended to turn you from your sin? Why is God so patient with us? Why is he so patient with anybody? Is it because he's soft on sin? Is it because he's approving of the sin? We don't ever want to mistake God's patience for approving of sin, right? Why is God so patient? Because he's giving us an opportunity to repent of our sin. And that's what he's doing here with these religious guys. Some of them will come around like Nicodemus or Joseph. Or yeah, like Nicodemus. Joseph of Arimathea. Maybe some other guys will get saved too. Some of them won't. Some of them won't take advantage of God's patience. The Apostle Paul is another guy. He might be in this group at this point. In 2 Peter chapter 3, Peter brings up the argument and says, in the last days, scoffers will come and say, where's your God now? You born-againers, always talking about the rapture, you know. It's been 2,000 years. He hasn't come back yet. And what does Peter say? No, he's not slack concerning his promise, but he's patient, and he's waiting for people to repent. And that's what we see right here. God's patience with these guys, incredible. So anyway, just wrapping it up, Judas here, very calloused-hearted. How's your heart this morning? Judas had a heart that was desensitized. How's your heart? Judas's heart couldn't feel anything anymore. Judas, it's like he couldn't hear the voice of the Lord anymore. How's your heart? Can you hear Jesus when he whispers to you? Do you still hear the Holy Spirit? Do you still weep when you read the scriptures? Can you hear God talk to you? Judas could no longer hear the voice of the Lord. His heart was so calloused. Peter got impulsive, and he fought the wrong battle with the wrong weapon. Our battle is a spiritual battle, isn't it? How much do we pray? And Caiaphas here, Caiaphas was a hard-hearted dude as well, right? And what was Caiaphas's deal? I don't think Caiaphas wanted to lose his power. He had all that money invested. He spent his whole life kind of climbing up the, you know, a ladder that was leaning up against the wrong wall, you know. And he finally gets up there and he sees, you know, this is my ladder's leaning up against the wrong wall. And Jesus proves it to him, but Caiaphas is too proud to change his mind. And so how are you doing this morning with that? Do you resist the lordship of Jesus because you're so invested in what you want? Caiaphas wanted to be his own Lord, and we see he just turns out to be a monster in front of Jesus when the idea comes up that Jesus is really the Lord. And lastly, I just wanted to close the way that I began here before Wayne comes up. Let us not grow weary, Galatians 6:9, while doing good, for in due season we'll reap if we don't lose heart. And Hebrews 12:3 says, consider Jesus, who endured such opposition from sinners so that you will not grow weary and lose heart. So it's been my prayer that as we go through this and we look at this passage, that we would be encouraged, that when we think and consider what Jesus went through for us, man, we would be strengthened. We wouldn't lose heart. Because what Jesus did here just tells us that he loves us. And one of the surefire ways to lose heart and check out is to start thinking that Jesus doesn't love you. Well, he loves other people, but I haven't blown it as bad as, you know, they haven't blown it as bad as me, you know. We always think we're the grand exception. God loves others, but not me. But when we read this passage, man, we should know Jesus. Jesus loves us. He loves us a whole bunch. Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. Well, I'm going to have Wayne come up, and he's going to lead us in this communion part of our service, and I'm going to have the worship team come up too. And so if you don't have this, make sure you get one of these right now. They're right out there. So come on up, Wayne.
Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this time that we can gather to remember what you did for us on the cross, Lord, willingly going all the way. Lord, so speak to our hearts, I pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. In 1 Corinthians chapter 11, Paul, talking about communion, says, "For I received from the Lord on the night in which he was betrayed." We were just talking about that. Pastor Eric's been talking about the night he was betrayed, he gave his communion. Before this happened, remember last week, Pastor Eric was talking about communion, how it was given during the Passover meal. This was a pretty crazy night for our Lord. After communion, he went to Gethsemane, three times praying to the Father, "This cup can pass from me." Said, "Nevertheless, I'm going, I'm doing it." And he knew this was coming. This is part of the things he knew that was coming on the night that he was betrayed. And Paul gives us three things to look at here in 1 Corinthians chapter 11. He tells us in verse 28 to let a man examine himself. That's a good thing to do before we take communion, is to examine ourselves. Where are we at with the Lord? We take communion here once a month, you know, so it's a good time to look back. Last month, what was am I closer to the Lord than I was a month ago? If not, why? Examine yourself and find out why. This is a good time to get right, to repent of things, and to just get yourself right before the Lord before you take the cup. And then he says, do this in remembrance of me. And that's in the present. That's right now. But just, you know, it's hard to, again, you know, examine yourself without looking back to the past. Where it says, do this in remembrance of me now. And that's where it becomes personal. He did this for us, each one. Corporately, yes, for the world, yes, but he's personal God. You're each one of us personally. And then what I love about, he says, we take this, we do this until he comes. And I love that part. So we're looking to the future. Until he comes. When we're with him, we don't have to do this anymore. We're doing this now. I'll just speak for myself because I'm stupid. I forget. It's so easy to forget what the Lord did for me. That's why he says do this often. We need to be reminded over and over again. But when we're with him, we don't need to be reminded anymore because we'll be seeing him face to face for all eternity. So, to our passage. For I received from the Lord, which I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, take, eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same manner, he also took the cup after and saying, this cup is a new covenant in my blood. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death till he comes. Therefore, whoever eats this bread and drinks this cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of the body and the blood of the Lord. But let a man examine himself, and so let him eat of that bread and drink of that cup. We're going to take the bread together. He said, do this in remembrance of me. So, Lord, we do remember your body broken, what this cracker, this bread, whatever we're taking at home. Lord, that this is a representation of what you did for us, willingly giving your body to be broken for us. Lord, we thank you and we praise you for that in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's take the cracker together. And then he says he took the cup. And it represents the blood of Christ. He said, do this in remembrance of me. Heavenly Father, we praise you and we thank you. What this cup represents, your blood shed for us, Lord. Willingly again, Lord, you went all the way. You went all the way for us, Lord. Help us to go all the way for you, Lord. We thank you that by your stripes we are healed. Because of your shed blood we can and are forgiven. So, Lord, we can't praise you enough for what this cup represents. In Jesus' name, amen.
Let's all stand together, amen.
Walk the hill.
all the goodness, for your greatness, Lord, for your grace that gives us every day, Lord, that fresh grace. Father, we thank you so much for the remembrance, as our brother was saying, that we can look forward to the promises that you have given us, Lord, because of what you have done. Father, we ask you that you would just protect us as you always do, Lord. Watch over us. Father, watch over for all those that are even watched online, Lord. We give you praise, we give you glory, and we give you all the honor that you so much deserve, Father. And we ask you this in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Thank you all for coming.
Thank you.
is gracious. How do I get eternal life? Trust in the man who gave his life. I know it's hard just to comprehend. How can a man die and rise again?
Goodness, goodness, goodness.